I want to welcome you to this Wednesday evening service of First Baptist Church in Lucedale, Mississippi. This is the first Wednesday service of 2023, and so we're looking forward to the coming year and what God will do. Tonight, I want to talk to you about leaving a spiritual legacy. Over the last month or so, I've observed what I believe to be a problem in our church. We're not passing on a spiritual legacy to our children. We're not modeling obedience to the voice of God, and our children don't know how to obey God. We're not telling them about our own experience with God, so our children don't have a model or a picture in their minds of what to expect. In practice, in our own worship, our children don't know what it means to respond to God, because they see no one else modeling a response to God. Do you follow what I'm saying? Do you understand the point I'm trying to make? Tonight, I want to show you how it is your spiritual responsibility to leave a spiritual legacy that will inspire them to look and long for an experience with God. They need more than knowledge about God. It's good to teach them. They need to experience God. They need to encounter Him. Now, if you say it's not practical to anticipate an encounter with God, then I would refer you to the Scripture, for what we have there are stories of those who, in fact, did encounter Him, and they were instructed by God to share the testimony of that encounter. In Experiencing God, the study, Henry Blackaby, the author, called those encounters spiritual markers. I love that term because it helps me put a handle on some moments in my life. Blackaby defines a spiritual marker as a moment when you clearly know that God was speaking to you. In his words, a spiritual marker identifies a time of transition, decision, or direction when you clearly know that God has guided you. He bases this on the following passage in Joshua. This is the story of when they crossed the Jordan on dry ground. As you know, the children of Israel passed through the Red Sea on dry ground, but when they came to the Promised Land, the same thing happened to the Jordan. The Jordan parted, and they were able to cross on the dry ground. From Joshua chapter 4, verses 1 through 7, the Bible says, "When all the nation had finished passing over the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, 'Take 12 men from the people, from each tribe a man, and command them, saying, Take 12 stones from here, out of the midst of the Jordan, from the very place where the priest's feet stood firmly, and bring them over with you, and lay them down in the place where you lodge tonight.' Then Joshua called the 12 men from the people of Israel, whom he had appointed, a man from each tribe, and Joshua said to them, 'Pass on before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of the Jordan, and take up each of you a stone upon his shoulder, according to the number of tribes of the people of Israel, that this may be a sign among you. When your children ask in time to come, What do these stones mean? Then you shall tell them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. When it passed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. So these stones shall be to the people of Israel a memorial forever.'" So you see here, the stones became physical reminders of a tremendous spiritual experience. They were to erect those markers that they might remember what happened. But not only so, those questions would raise questions in the lives of their children in years to come, and they were to tell their children about the things that God had done. We're not doing that here. We're not modeling a responsiveness to God to our children and young people. We're not sharing with them our own spiritual markers, and as a result, they are themselves disoriented about how they ought to respond to God. I call your attention to the fourth chapter of Deuteronomy. This is where God gripped my heart. I think I have identified for you the pinnacle of all worship experiences in the Old Testament. That happens in the 19th and 20th chapter of the book of Exodus. You can't imagine a moment of any greater spiritual significance. It was an encounter with God at Mount Sinai. God's people had been so influenced by Egyptian culture that they lost their sense of who the true God was and what He was like. So He brought them out of Egypt in order to reveal Himself in a way that they would never forget. Moses rehearses that experience for them in the 4th chapter of Deuteronomy. You must understand that the book of Deuteronomy is written at the end of their 40 years in the wilderness. He was reintroducing this experience now to another generation, reminding them of things that God had done, and clearly reminding them to pass these spiritual markers on to their children. He says in Deuteronomy 4, verse 9, "Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children, how on the day that you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, the Lord said to me, 'Gather the people to me, that I may let them hear my words, so that they may learn to fear me all the days they live on the earth, and that they may teach their children so.' And you came near and stood at the foot of the mountain, while the mountain burned with fire to the heart of heaven, wrapped in darkness, cloud, and gloom. Then the Lord spoke to you out of the midst of the fire. You heard the sound of words, but saw no form. There was only a voice. And He declared to you His covenant, which He commanded you to perform, that is, the Ten Commandments. And He wrote them on two tablets of stone." I want to ask you a question. What spiritual legacy are you leaving the children and the young people in this church? Did you know that over the past month we've had people who wanted to respond to God, but simply didn't know how? They haven't seen anybody respond to God in their church. They sincerely wanted to respond, but had no model, no standard, no pattern that they could follow. Why is that? It's because no one responds to God in our church. No one gives a testimony of how they've responded to God in the past. No one shares a spiritual marker about when God spoke to them. The other day I was speaking to a person who used to go to this church, and he said, "I wish I could just come in there and tell people and point to the spot where God spoke to my heart, and point to the spot where I accepted Christ, and point to the spot where I was baptized." Those were spiritual markers in his life. Not only so, but there should be spiritual markers like these in the Old Testament. These weren't spiritual markers of individuals. These were spiritual markers that impacted the entire congregation. They experienced God's activity. They were left with a testimony about the greatness and glory of God. I'm telling you that your church should have a legacy of revival. First, you need one, not a series of services. Instead, your church needs an encounter with God. You need God to move and reveal Himself in the midst of this church in such a way that generations from now, people will still be telling the story of something only God could do. That's the kind of legacy that you need. But if any one of you has ever had such an experience with God, the children and the young people would never know it. First, because you're not telling them of your encounter with God. And second, because you're not modeling a responsiveness to God. If it is because we're not sensing God in His presence and power, then we all need to be on our faces asking God to manifest His presence in our church. I also want to remind you that both in Scripture and in the great revivals in the history of the church, God has always used some person as a catalyst. God spoke to that person, and their obedient response to God became the first in a series of dominoes that began to fall. As I see it in this church, there are multiple generations who've yet to experience God mightily. God is the glue that holds the church together. It is not who the pastor is. It is not who the deacons are. It is the working and moving of the Holy Spirit. On different occasions, I have been a part of some major renovation of the sanctuary of some church. The renovations were on such a scale that we had to be out of the sanctuary for several months. When we returned to the sanctuary, it was completely different. It was like a different place. The whole atmosphere of the place was different. It was as if it had somehow been sanctified by the hand of God. But I always reminded the people that the house of the Lord, is just a house if God is not in it. Nothing sanctifies the sanctuary like the presence of God. People are always looking for things to sanctify the sanctuary. The music, the songs, the organ, the preaching, the pulpit. Do you think there was an organ or music or a certain set of songs on Mount Sinai? What was unique about that experience was that God was present on that mountain. They heard from God, and the fear of God overwhelmed them from Moses to the last person there. Let me read you again from the book of Deuteronomy, beginning in the 23rd verse of chapter 5. And as soon as you heard the voice out of the midst of darkness, while the mountain was burning with fire, you came near to me, all the heads of your tribes and your elders, and you said, "Behold, the Lord our God has shown us His glory and greatness, and we have heard His voice out of the midst of the fire. This day we have seen God speak with man and still live. And therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us. If we hear the voice of the Lord our God any more, we shall die. For who is there of all flesh that has heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of fire as we have and still lived? Go near and hear all that the Lord our God will say, and speak to us all that the Lord our God will speak to you, and we will hear and do it. And the Lord heard your words when you spoke to me. And the Lord said to me, I have heard the words of this people which they have spoken to you. They are right in all that they have spoken. Oh, that they had such a heart as this always to fear me and keep my commandments, that it might go well with them and with their descendants forever." Do you see the impact of this encounter upon their lives? This is the spiritual legacy your church needs. You need an encounter with God. You need to pray for it. You need to long for it. You need to leave the legacy of revival to the coming generations. You must leave them a story that they can tell to their children and to their children's children about an experience with God. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you.